This is Grow Omaha Uncut, where you can watch our radio show, including what goes on in the commercial breaks. And be sure to hit those like and subscribe buttons.
Well, good morning and welcome to the show. Jeff Beals here at your service. We're brought to you by Dingman's Collision Center and D&M Roofing and Siding. This is the only show in the metro area that talks about business development, commercial real estate, construction, just to fun and exciting things that have to do with Omaha becoming bigger and more prosperous. Well, without any further ado, it's time to bring on my long-missed, absent, wandering in the wilderness, gone for the last couple weeks, co-host Trenton Magid.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, Jeff.
Good morning. Where on earth were you?
We took a sojourn to Spain for a couple of weeks.
How was Spain?
The rain in Spain falls mainly in the plains.
That's what they say in My Fair Lady.
Yep. Someone sent that to me. Spain, the rain is gorgeous, in Spain, and the weather, short sleeves. I had one long sleeve shirt night. That was it, and a lot of shorts. And so September, end of September, October, early October is great in Spain. But as it pertains to growth and development, I can totally see how the Omaha stakeholders have a major push for the streetcar, for scooters, mopeds, motorcycles. The multi modes of transportation is definitely prevalent, at least in Spain, and I know throughout Europe, and people use those modes of transportation.
Yeah, if there's anywhere that has really done a good job with public transit and multi modes of transit, it's those countries in Europe, to be sure.
Yeah, and there's like a different word for everything over there.
That's uncanny. It's uncanny how they do that. Well, we missed you. It's good to have you back. And while you were gone, we kept the fires burning. And one of the things that happened while you were gone was that Sarah Baker Hansen did a review, and we published it on Thursday, as we do every other week. It's part of our Grow Omaha Eats series with Sarah Baker Hansen. And this week she reviewed Hacienda Real, which is a Mexican restaurant that opened earlier this year at 78th and Cass, site of a former old Chicago. Very good place. So if you want to read that review, you can do so by going to growomaha.com and clicking on Eats, E-A-T-S, on the navigation bar. And as always, our Grow Omaha Eats with Sarah Baker Hansen series is sponsored by Cheer Athletics, which is the nation's top all-star cheer gym. 12 locations in the world, one of them here in Omaha. And it's located near Highway 50 and 370. If you go to 50, 370, just go a couple blocks south, and it's in one of those big warehouse buildings. They have to have a high ceiling because of all the...
It's a beautiful facility. And cheers to Sarah Baker Hansen, because... and I've been to Hacienda Real, and it was good, and it's a welcome addition to the restaurant scene.
Yeah, I've been there a couple times, actually, only for lunch. I've not tried it yet for dinner, but I agree. Good stuff, great atmosphere, big restaurant. There's a lot of room in there.
I didn't realize they had a few other restaurants.
Yeah, it's out of Lincoln, and I think they have two locations down there in Lincoln. But yeah, good stuff. So Sarah reviews restaurants regularly, and you can see that and all of her past reviews at growomaha.com. All right, well, let's go into our news of the week, which is brought to you by Eagle Mortgage, eaglemortgagecompany.com. And a lot of people will say, you know, why do you use a broker like Eagle Mortgage as opposed to just going to your bank or something like that? Well, brokers like Eagle Mortgage, on average, save homeowners $9,000 over the life of a loan compared to regular banks. In fact, in 2021, the average borrower savings was $9,407 between upfront cost savings and interest savings. So it's still a great time to do a mortgage. Just make sure you go to the right mortgage broker, and that is Eagle Mortgage. You can find them in person, 114th and Davenport, or online at eaglemortgagecompany.com. All right, Trenton, the final designs came in for the Mutual of Omaha Tower. last January. Mutual released a rendering of it. It was just a rough rendering because it wasn't a done deal. They hadn't 100% committed to it because they were waiting for the city to do its part with the streetcar. They did that a while back. So Mutual had its architect go ahead and complete the final designs, because you may recall when it was first announced as a possibility last winter, they didn't know the exact height. Remember, the CEO of Mutual Omaha said in relation to the First National Tower, it'll be close.
He was being kind.
He was being kind. Well, it's going to be 677 feet tall. That is 43 feet taller than the First National Bank Tower, which is currently the tallest building in Nebraska, Iowa, Missouri, Kansas, Wyoming, the Dakotas, several other places. That 677 feet will have 44 stories and 800,000 square feet of floor space.
So what people forget to take into account is elevation, because I remember when this First National Tower, doesn't it sit higher than the Woodman?
Now, the Woodman sits a little bit higher than the First National, okay. And the First National will sit a little higher than the Mutual of Omaha. So when you're, say, if you're driving on I-29 by Missouri Valley or Glenwood, Iowa, and you see the Omaha skyline in the distance, the Mutual Tower, I believe, will look just a smidge taller than the First National Tower, because
that explains the extra 3 feet.
If I understand correctly, it might be about, oh, say a 20 or 30 foot difference, actually.
Okay.
Even though it doesn't seem like it.
Omaha's
not
flat, ladies and gentlemen. Rolling hills.
Well, and that hill comes up from the Missouri River.
For our international listeners.
All of them, yeah. All of the international listeners. Okay. So that's news there. And in fact, if you want to kind of get in and be a little nerdy about the height of the building and how it compares, we have an article in
this. I thought you were talking about yourself in high school, but go ahead.
It's a flashback. We have an article in this week's newsletter, and you can get the newsletter at growomaha.com. Just go to market report on the navigation bar. But in that article, we compare the building's height to all the other buildings in Nebraska, the region around here, and then a list of cities, other major cities. This is kind of fun if you want to geek out on that a little bit.
How old is First National Tower? Because it's 20?
It was either 2002 or 2003. Okay, Roger Olson says 2003.
And Roger is always right. So it is a generational event. If someone wants to build a $600 million or $600 million tower, let them do it.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's good for a city. Having those skylines makes a psychological statement to both residents and visitors that we're serious about business.
And if you also go to our Facebook page, the Grow Omaha Facebook page, Jeff and I got a little bit touchy about one of our. You can listen to the conversation. Jeff doesn't want me to get into it, but. People were asking about, why does it matter that we talk about height and size?
Actually, I would say we've always had two red meat discussion topics on Grow Omaha. One would be, everyone likes to know new restaurants and retailers, and we talk about that quite a bit. In fact, that's one of the biggest reasons why a lot of our listeners and readers are with us. The other one is tall buildings. People just love to talk about tall buildings, and they do generate a lot of discussion, a lot of excitement. And some people, they even have angst over tall buildings. Like, I can remember an architect telling me once that a lot of people are, quote, intimidated to walk by a tall building. And I remember thinking, he was walking down the sidewalk and be like, oh my God, it's so scary. That building's so tall. But apparently some people, according to architects, are intimidated.
I wonder if there's a skyscraper phobia.
Yeah, and if so, what would the name of it be?
All right. We'll take those calls.
Well, the Omaha Planning Board approved tax increment financing for a $2.2 million redevelopment project on North 24th Street. Exact address is 3819. This is the 97-year-old Native Omaha Club building. It's not big. It's only two stories and a little over 7,200 square feet, but it's a cool-looking building. And it's going to have commercial space on the ground floor and apartments upstairs on the second, about three apartments. So again, not a big building, but kind of cool. And it's always good to see those renovations on the North 24th Street corridor. Trenton, you'll be happy to know that Omaha was ranked as the 15th best minor league sports market by Sports Business Journal, trade publication. So here's the deal. The article and the study associated with it considered 195 minor league markets. And these minor league markets together are home to 34 sports leagues, 320 professional teams, and together they attract 191 million fans per year. So Charleston, South Carolina was number one, followed by Fort Wayne, Indiana, and Tulsa, Oklahoma. So Omaha being 15th, we have a couple pro sports teams.
We got room for improvement.
Yep, we've got room for improvement, and we probably have room for more. We have the AAA Omaha Storm Chasers, and we have Union Omaha, but we don't have the D-League NBA teams that some cities have, or there are some other pro sports minor league teams
out
there.
Well, I was excited, and you probably have for later in the show, but I was very excited to see that we're going after the U.S. Olympic trials for gymnastics.
Funny you should mention that. That was next on the docket. And that event for the previous Olympics was held in St. Louis, and it appears as if St. Louis is bidding for it again. We don't necessarily know what other cities might be bidding for it, but I can remember, you know, thinking a couple times over the years when we've hosted the swim trials, Omaha always does such a great job with athletic events and special events. And I remember thinking even years ago, gosh, we should go after gymnastics because everybody loves gymnastics and it's an indoor thing. It's not like you have to have like an Olympic track stadium or anything like that. But interesting to see how that one plays out.
It's kind of like skating or swimming where you don't have to watch it all the time or whatever. But when it comes to your city, we supported swimming so well. I think that Omaha would support gymnastics incredibly.
You know, it doesn't really matter. I mean, shoot, we did the curling championships here, and people packed that. And I mean, I was thrilled we had that, but I'm going to be brutally honest with you. I don't find that interesting to watch at all.
And I went to it. I agree with you.
And I went to one. It was cool to have it. So I went for the event, but the sport itself, it is what it is, but it's the event, and that's why people turn out.
They wouldn't let me in with my broom. I was a little upset about that.
Oh, I thought, you know, maybe you could bring something like that, just because, you know, how like football fans will wear their favorite player's jersey, or sometimes people wear their ball glove to the baseball game. Why the hell couldn't you bring a broom?
I agree.
All right.
That's a regulation, apparently.
News of the week brought to you by Eagle Mortgage, eaglemortgagecompany.com. They know mortgages like nobody knows mortgages. You can find them in person, 114th and Davenport. Going to take our first break of the hour, and when we come back, we're going to bring on one of our friends and colleagues, John Meyer. He is an industrial specialist, does some other things too, but at NAINP Dodge Commercial Real Estate. We're going to talk about the industrial market. And for those of you who are not commercial real estate aficionados, this is going to be more interesting than you might think, because industrial real estate drives the world and there's a severe shortage of it. You're listening to Jeff and Trenton on Grow Omaha, brought to you by Dingman's Collision Center and D&M Roofing and Siding. Back in a moment on News Radio 1110 KFAB.
This is Darcy with
Dingman's Collision Center. Come on in, John.
All right. Little King's going to open November 1.
Yeah. November 1. Okay. Yeah. Oh, thank you. What's that?
Megalophobia.
Fear of large objects included. Okay, we're going to put that. Thank you, Raj. Megalophobia.
Megalophobia.
Good to see you, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, how do we want to come into this?
Trenton, can you move this?
We can just free flow. We can free flow. I mean, I don't know. We just talk about the vacancy rate. Okay. You know, we've got, I've got like a couple different markets, sub-markets that we can talk about.
Perfect.
You know,
okay.
Everything that's going on down by the airport.
We just talk about how fast some of the deals we've done that are just goes fast because of the...
And how quick you got to move because of the demand.
And I do like to talk about some of the stuff at the airport, because I find it interesting that there had been a lull.
Yeah, so I thought Krejci's building was almost done. So is it just like...
I think they're moving on it.
But they don't have walls up or anything yet?
I don't know. I haven't been down there yet. I got to get down there. But
Do you know...
And then what about Green Slate? You know how they're gonna get into the industrial
thing by the airport,
and then there's
we don't mention names or competitors though.
They're not really competitors.
We try not to, but we don't. We give them enough love on here.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah. Not gonna give them. Buy an ad, Green Slate.
Cheapskate.
Taiwan.
Okay.
So friendly competitors.
And then, you know, I think the other stuff that's really interesting is what's going on in Council Bluffs.
They've been on the show.
That's true.
And then Pacific Junction has 600. There's 600,000 square feet going in Pacific Junction.
Really?
Yeah.
Pacific Junction, Iowa?
Proposed, yep.
Well, right on
I-29.
Yep. I think that's the deal that Tucker
flooded
out on.
Fucinero excavating or Fucinero or whatever it is.
I did the PJ exit.
Do they have a user for it? Wasn't there a big cattle...
is the PJ exit north or south of Glenwood?
South.
Okay, so it's south, so it's not the Highway 34.
Isn't there like some kind of cattleman something... Was there a big development like about a year ago or something?
Yeah, but wasn't that going to be more at the 34 Glenwood exit?
And then we could talk about some of the deals that we've put together recently.
Yeah.
I've been hearing there might be a mega site down by Glenwood.
I wonder if that's the one you're talking about.
Could be a mega site down by Glenwood. Like 2,000 acres or something crazy like that.
A maga?
Maga site, yeah. Oh, it's going to be rag. It's going to be rag. This is all recorded.
Make Glenwood great again.
Make.
That's an
Magaga.
Make Glenwood great again.
Yeah.
They love Glenwood.
I'd say it's not ungreat.
Here we go.
Okay, we're back. Local and national news talk podcasts and videos. And welcome back to the show. Jeff Beal sitting next to Trenton Magid. And we are brought to you by Dingman's Collision Center and D&M Roofing and Siding. If you are in the market for a new roof, we're going to make your job a lot easier for you. Call D&M Roofing. Eric Obrumt and his team there do such a great job with both residential and commercial roofs. In fact, if you make decisions about a commercial building, you're going to want to check out D&M Roofing and Siding's special preventative maintenance program. There's nothing else like it. It's top notch. You can find them online at dandmroofing.com. Well, we're going to talk a little bit about the industrial market, the industrial real estate market, that is, because it's extremely tight. There's hardly any industrial space available yet, with all of the supply chain issues and repatriation of manufacturing in the United States. We need more industrial space. So we have one of our colleagues with us from NAI NP Dodge, John Meyer, joining us. Good morning, John. Welcome back to the show.
Good morning, guys. Thanks for having me here.
Yeah, good to have you here. And so, you know, you're like a lot of the brokers that we have over at NP Dodge. You do a lot of things, but your focus is industrial.
Yeah, I do a lot of industrial leasing and a lot of industrial sales, and then also plenty of other just general investment sales is what I pretty much focus on. So
I said the market is tight, the vacancy is low. What exactly is the vacancy right now?
It's about 2.6%. So it's pretty tight, like you said, you know. And then, you know, I think the average rental rate out there is about 718 square foot, which is pretty crazy to think about, you know, from where it was when I, you know, kind of got into the biz about 5 years ago or so. It's increased pretty quick.
I remember the over-under on industrial space about 29 years ago when I got in the business. It was like $4.50, $4.25, and like $5 a foot was the and that's plus operating expenses. But I remember that there was like the ceiling of $5 that when people started going above $5, just a crazy thing. In the last 5-10 years, the prices have really taken off. You and I just did a deal. What is it, 67,000 square foot deal together out at Miller Lumber's building. It's an older building, but in great shape. Great folks over there, a bunch of docks, a couple drive doors, and we sent it out to the world, and we didn't have to put up a sign.
We were done with it almost within a week from going through it the first time.
With minimal improvements and a great tenant and great landlord and. That's kind of the story of the industrial. You and I are working on a couple other big deals, one 40,000 feet, and we have one need. If anybody's listening that has a space coming available more or less than 40,000 square feet, we've got a national tenant ready to go. And that $7 plus is mostly the newer stuff, you know, higher ceilings, docks and drives, sometimes just docks. But even the Class B and C stuff, the older stuff with like 18-foot ceilings or 14-foot ceilings, still come at a premium, right?
You're still getting those at seven. I'd say that, honestly, I've gotten a couple of deals done. Well, that other deal you and I did together, you brought the tenant, represented my good friend Terry Wachnick, who is building that 45,000-square-footer over off of Centennial.
General Concrete.
General Concrete. But, yeah, he... We're getting like close to $8 a square foot there.
And that's
brand new.
That's a brand new building. But even the older stuff are going above $6, $7.
$7 all day because the demand's there.
It's just so expensive to build industrial space. The land is expensive, the lead time. And so existing industrial space, and there's industrial space and warehouse space for storage and distribution. And then there's also what we call flex space, which has office and warehouse that is flexible between the two. And generally that's a little bit smaller, but it's all in big demand right now.
I also did a second gen deal though that was that came out to be about eight something a square foot over at Grunewald Mechanical's new building.
What do you see? Do you think this is going to hold for a couple of years?
I don't see it going down anytime soon. You know, especially in the true warehouse distribution side of things. You know, with online demand and shopping and all that stuff, it's really driven the need. And then not to mention just like the fear that COVID has instilled in some of these larger companies, right? They want to have inventory. They want to have stock here. They don't want to have to wait for things to come over from overseas. They want to get it over here, store it, have it on hand. They don't, you know, they're worried about supply chain interruptions.
Are you seeing much manufacturing uses as opposed to distribution and storage?
Yeah, there's different manufacturers that are looking to set up shop. You know, there's also a lot of R&D stuff that I've seen kind of coming in to town here. So,
and it's really interesting that the one of the deals that we did was Metropolitan Warehouse, where they've got probably 300 clients, but if you buy furniture or you buy something big at Costco, they are the white glove delivery service, and they're in dozens of markets throughout the country, but they're coming to Omaha right now. They deliver from Kansas City into Omaha. We've got a colleague that used them and just love their service, and it's just really unique, the people that are taking up warehouse space. We get a call probably once a week for softball, football, soccer, all kinds of indoor training too, which is weird.
Well, it's impossible to get those guys. You know, if you're going to go to a landlord and say, "Hey, I got a tenant here, you know, that needs all these special build outs for your warehouse," it's impossible to get those deals done because as a landlord, you're going to want to go with the distribution company who just needs to come in and take the warehouse
and
as
take
is.
Take 1,000 square feet of office.
Call it good, you know, and have to worry about tearing that out.
Tell us about what's going on down by the airport.
You know, there's a lot of stuff going on down there. There's a couple of larger developers here in town that, you know, one in particular is trying to get into the industrial realm, who's I think they're slated to put up, what, like a, I think like a 300,000-400,000 square foot building down there. And then there's another developer down there doing two other developers doing.
Well, Frank Creechy, before he passed, and he was on the drawing boards for a couple of years, was about 160,000.
Yeah, 150,000 square feet down there.
And that one's in the triangle-shaped piece of land where Abbott Drive and stores split north of the airport.
Right by the Postal Service.
Why do you guys think it took so long to develop that area?
I don't know if it was floodplain issues or, you know, but, I mean, also it's just like access, I think, to the interstate.
But to the interstate and the airport, are we getting more freight or something?
Well, that could be, but I think the big reason is so much of the Sarpy County industrial ground has been taken, and maybe there are some users that want to be more like East Omaha, and they probably figure, hey, it's available, it's close to the airport, maybe that's a bonus.
Well, and you know, when I got into the business about 5 years ago, there's like, you know, if I would have told you that people are seriously considering doing any type of industrial development or development in general along Highway 133 going to Blair, you'd call me crazy. But, you know, we've got data centers going out off of State Street out there. You've got people buying at all-time high prices land out there to develop different industrial uses.
And when you take a farm, especially if it's not flat, you're talking a couple years by the time you're going to have buildings going.
Oh, yeah. The elevation changes there, to the topography of it all.
You got to have sewer, all that kind of good stuff.
So John, what about a couple other parts of town? I noticed I was driving on Interstate 29 last week, and right southeast of Ameristar Casino, big, long, looked like about 300,000 square foot industrial building being squeezed in there by Warren Distribution. And you're starting to see that. You kind of hinted about that with the 133 corridor. But people, because the market's so hot, they're just sticking industrial buildings where they can get them.
Right. I mean, I'm not 100% certain what's going on with the development down by Pacific Junction off of I-29, but there is a proposed 600,000 square foot facility going in there, which, you know, would never dream of that happening either anytime.
And for a little perspective for people that aren't real estate experts, a 600,000 square foot building is the square footage of 3 Walmart supercenters thereabout. So, I mean, we're talking a lot of space for Pacific Junction, Iowa.
Yeah, they're a lot taller than Walmarts, too.
True, like 32 feet 30 ceilings.
30-some feet ceilings. Yep. You know, so that's one area. You know, Bellevue, there's a 600,000 square foot proposed building that's supposed to go in down off of Bellevue, off of Highway 75, just south of Offutt as well.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and then there's a lot of grading of land when you start to, when you're in Gretna on I-80, kind of heading out of the developed part of the Omaha metro area that is going to be industrial. It just and then R&R is building a bunch of stuff in that area, so it's going crazy.
Yeah, it's going to be one out in Gretna is going to be one of the first cross dock facilities that Omaha seems on this scale of I think it's about supposed to be 400,000 square feet out there.
And tell us what a cross dock facility is. That basically where the trucks come in on one side of the building and they're able to get it right across the building to
they can
the
go
other truck
in and out.
Yeah.
Yep.
Super, super easy, super convenient. Well, John, we appreciate you joining us and giving us a little update on the office market. We'll have to do it again sometime in the future.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate you having me.
That's our colleague, John Meyer from NAINP Dodge. We're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, we'll have our commercial real estate development spotlight brought to you by Noddle Companies. And we're also going to talk about Giving Tuesday, which is coming up on the horizon. And before we go, we're going to answer a question for you. Megalophobia is the fear of large objects, including skyscrapers. Trenton wanted to know what that was called, if you had a phobia of skyscrapers.
Absolutely.
And your microphone's not on.
That came both from...
there you go.
Roger Olson on the board, our producer, and also Jeannie Evans, who is the first lady of Gretna. Mike Evans... wrote in and said that that's what it is. So people are out there listening. We appreciate it, Jeannie and Roger, and we're going to break.
You're listening to Girl Omaha, brought to you by Dingman's Collision Center and D&M Roofing. Back in a moment on News Radio 1110 KFAB.
Do you have someone
giving
you a no call?
All right, good stuff.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah, thanks for doing it.
Yeah, it's fun.
Yeah.
He literally, right as I was saying it, I was like, she spells it G-E-N-I, and so I'm like, Jenny? And he's like, as in I dream of. But he was like still typing, and I'm like,
As in I dream of.
Thanks for the cross dock help there. I was like blanking.
Oh,
I
didn't
know how to explain it.
I will tell you after 19 years.
How do you describe it? I didn't hear it. I was doing this.
Oh, yeah.
In and out.
In and out. And after 19 years.
That's what Hamburger is all about.
You just kind of get so used to it. Like,
I looked at you and I was like,
what did you ask? He asked you?
No, he asked me. I didn't know how to describe it, though. I just blanked and I'm like, I don't know.
Like, you know how when they come in from one side and they can load the other side?
Yeah. I'm like, okay, thanks, Jeff.
That's what we do around here.
Oh, God.
Oh, man, that was fun.
No, it was great. What are you guys up to the rest of the day?
You know, I think I got to get a whole bunch of stuff done around the house and shit like that. Yeah. Oh, nice. What about you?
I gotta go babysit.
I'm having lunch.
And by babysit, I mean hang out with my 7-month-old daughter.
Your own daughter.
I'm having lunch with Sam Clark Jr., which is Janet Clark and Sam Clark. You know Sam?
He's an
Erickson Cederstrom, I think. He's an attorney. You don't know
Janet's son?
Yeah, you know?
No,
he's like 31. You're 32? Metro, 33.
Okay, yeah, he's about my age.
Yeah, I think we're in the West Side.
John, we're not kicking you out, but Mark,
no, I'm out of
that
here.
Chair.
No, you're out.
But you can
I'm good.
You can stay if you want to stand.
I'm going to listen. From
nice
the car.
Nice work.
We'll talk soon,
guys.
Girl.
Hey, okay. Thanks, guys. We'll talk soon.
All right, enjoy your weekend.
Good to see you.
We have a 20-minute delay, so you might hear yourself.
We'll see you guys later.
See ya. Actually, that was kind of the deal, that delay. There were times when we used to, remember we would come in and do that Wednesday bit?
And hear it on the way
and
out.
Then I'd leave real fast and I'd get to the car. By the time I'd get to the car, I'd hear the last few seconds of us.
Yeah, well, how long was that delay?
About 20 seconds.
20. Oh, wow, that's quick.
Yeah.
How can that work?
I just say the last thing. Say bye, guys. Got the car turned on. I'd hear the last couple seconds of what we said. Yeah. Well, plus I walk fast.
Get your updated vaccine now. It could save your life.
Fast. I love that commercial. You missed the part, but it's for My Pillow. This woman lies down on the pillow, and she's dressed in full outfit. Hair's perfect. Makeup's perfect. And she's just like, who lays on a pillow that way?
Nobody does.
Oh, you go, you scrub your face, you put on your jammies, you lay down, your hair's all messed up.
You scrub your face?
It's definitely does. Properties. I don't wear makeup. Provide preventative analysis
to potential damage anymore. Repair and
documentation. Just for the theater.
I looked up the philanthropic leaders in the cities, leading cities in the country, and Kansas City is the closest that's ranked in the top 25.
All right. We're not, are we not in there?
No, we're not. I think that's the reason I'm not tracking.
Are we too small of a city? Or?
I think population-wise, we're in a different bracket than those other communities. But if you compare us to like Wichita and Topeka, things like that, Des Moines, we're doing awesome. So,
but did we rank on smaller cities?
There is no smaller cities official ranking.
Yeah, but I mean, the population matters. I mean, Kansas City is double our size. I mean, you're talking 2 million to 1 million. And actually, there are probably 2.2 million to our 1 million. So, I mean, you can't compete very well with that.
Exactly. But like, on the markers that they were judging on, like
per capita, they kick their butts.
Per capita, they kick our butts. But, like, CEO salary, community foundation involvement, number of nonprofits, like, we compete on those other factors. I would guarantee we do.
And we got to be great per capita.
But I'm sure the population is the biggest reason we're
not
on that
top. You think, like, Heritage or one of those, or Omaha Community Foundation would have, like, funded some kind of study for that.
Yeah, to beat the chestnut. But, like, you look at Minneapolis. When you go to Minneapolis is more than three times the size of Omaha, the metro area. It doesn't feel like it though when you go there, but it is.
It is. Yeah, the university has, like, 55,000 students.
Yeah, it's most year. I haven't checked it in a few years, but I remember a few years ago when I checked, it was always in the top three most, or biggest universities by enrollment. Like Ohio State, Michigan, Texas are right up there.
Austin, Texas, yeah, the biggest, one of the biggest.
And Minnesota, those ones are always up there. A lot of Big Ten schools are the biggest. But then in recent years, like I think a couple of not as prestigious schools but happen to be like in Florida, like UCF in Florida has become one of the biggest, and that's not necessarily prestigious, not bad, but.
No, but it's interesting.
Yeah, and I think one of the schools in some of California has become, and not like a USC or UCLA, but one that maybe is not the most prestigious has become huge. I gotta look it up and see which one it was.
That does a lot for their economic development.
It's got to.
It has to.
In fact, just out of curiosity, let's see. Largest university enrollments.
Have you heard this commercial?
University of Central Florida, according to this list, has moved up to number one in the whole country, if you can trust Wikipedia.
For what?
Enrollment size.
Enrollment, yeah.
Seriously?
Top 10 largest public university campuses by enrollment. Oh, number one, Texas A&M. Number two, UCF. Number three, Ohio State. Number four, University of Florida. Number five, Florida International.
Wow.
Number six, University of Illinois. Seven, Arizona State. Eight, Georgia State. Number nine, University of Texas at Austin. 10, University of Minnesota.
Does Florida International have sports teams and stuff like that?
They do. FIU. Yeah. But, you know, that's where there's so much growth.
Absolutely.
Texas is awesome.
But there's a correlation there. Absolutely.
Yeah. But I thought, like, I'm surprised. We can do this. I wouldn't have been surprised if Michigan was in the top 10, but they're not on this list.
But Georgia State, that surprises me.
Georgia State. Well, I see what happens sometimes. These schools just, not trying to offend anyone, but, you know, maybe not so rigorous to get into when they're in Atlanta, and maybe they've gone real aggressive with their enrollment goals.
But is that on campus?
It says 10 large, and this is Wikipedia, so it could be wrong. 10 largest public university campuses by enrollment 2021-22 academic year.
So it could be online enrollment.
Yeah, I was going to say some of them might have
yes.
versus yes. online.
Well, if you go online, then what? Like, Bellevue University, like, is huge. Not that big, but huge. Huge, yeah. Now, if you're not sure if you should be screened, talk to your doctor. What's that Southern New Hampshire one that advertises on TV all the time? You know, some school that no one's ever heard of now is like advertising all over the world and trying to.
That's an interesting marketing mix, right?
Yeah.
Like, why would you do that?
Yeah, that model is to be this big monster.
Like, spray it as far as you possibly can.
Kind of like the University of Phoenix model.
Exactly. Yeah. Stories, daily podcasts, contests, and all of our hosts' social media
links can be found right now on KFAB.com. And welcome back to the show. Jeff Beals and Trenton Maggot at your service. We're brought to you by D&M Roofing and also Dingman's Collision Center. Four metro area locations for Dingman's. Not only are they the number one body shop and repair destination in town, they also have mechanical repair services as well. It's time for the Commercial Real Estate Development Spotlight, brought to you by Noddle Companies. Our good friends at Noddle Companies are changing the world, changing the built environment, both here in Omaha and in many other cities across the country. In Omaha, Noddle Companies is developing projects like River's Edge, Steel Ridge, the Builders District downtown, many others. But perhaps their best known project is Exarban Village. And we've got some news coming out of Exarban Village. The 308 Boutique is opening a new location in the HDR headquarters building. That's 1917 South 67th Street. So Trenton, if you can picture the HDR headquarters, a soup and salad place is there. They have Green Belly. There's a real nice handbag store. There is a florist shop in there.
Right across from Pickleman's.
Yeah, on the south, kind of catty corner, but on the south part of the HDR building, that is where this 308 Boutique is going in.
So west is coming east?
Yeah, because 308 is the Western Nebraska area code. In fact, this business started in Holdridge, Nebraska about 8 years ago. They did open an Omaha location 3 years ago, and that is in the Elkhorn area at 725 North 210th Street. But it's women's clothing and apparel, and then also a big online business. So welcome 308 Boutique to Exarban Village, and that is your commercial real estate development spotlight of the week, brought to you by Noddle Companies, full service real estate development firm, and you can find out more about them at noddlecompanies.com. Well, we have Giving Tuesday coming up, and that is becoming quite the tradition every year in Omaha. And to help us talk about Giving Tuesday, we have Marjorie Moss. She is from Share Omaha. Good morning, Marjorie. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having us today. It means a lot to us.
Well, we appreciate everything that you and your colleagues are doing to make Omaha a better place. And I'm going to throw a big starting question out there for you. What exactly is Giving Tuesday for those who are not familiar?
Giving Tuesday is our region's largest annual giving celebration. It is always the Tuesday after Thanksgiving in the United States. It is a global holiday, actually. So around the world, they host it different days, obviously, because Thanksgiving doesn't really matter if you're in Western Europe, things of that nature. But in the United States, Giving Tuesday is a huge day. And prior to Share Omaha running it, running the facilitation and the coordination of that day, Omaha, it was a thing in Omaha before Share Omaha. And the community, through credit card receipts, things of that nature, raised about $800,000. Last year, with our coordination over the last 3 years, we've raised $5.5 million for philanthropy through all sources on Giving Tuesday.
That's awesome. And you don't charge the charities anything, right?
No, we do not. Our membership on the website is free. Their only responsibility is to keep their profiles updated. So nonprofits, the 700 plus nonprofits on our website, they post for their in-kind needs for products. They post for donation needs, volunteers, events, really rich content all year long. But Giving Tuesday is one of those big rallying moments where we call everybody to come to the website and make a big splash. And there's actually ShareOmaha.org and ShareIowa.org, newly launched and covers really the entire metropolitan area.
We're talking with Marjorie Moss from Share Omaha about Giving Tuesday. And in particular, we want you to tell us about the Giving Tuesday bonus fund.
Yes, and a big thank you. This was really a joint idea between Omaha Steaks, Share Omaha, and especially Todd Simon. He said business leaders, Omaha Steaks was a sponsor of our prize pool, kind of hourly prizes, randomly drawn, things of that nature. He's like, we can do more as a business community. So Omaha Steaks made a significant gift to start a bonus pool. Our goal is to reach, is for it to be about six, not to be about, be over six figures for the nonprofit community. And it's just really the most significant opportunity to rally together and raise support. And we are still attracting businesses to add to this pool. And we will be doing so as long as people are still interested in giving to it. So if you're a business leader and you feel compelled to be part of this leveraging fund that really forward-thinking philanthropic businesses and foundations are getting excited about. In addition to Omaha Steaks, early additions to the fund are from Kiewit and from PayPal. We're very excited to have them join into the fund as well. But this wouldn't be possible without Omaha Steaks and Todd Simon's vision.
And other than cash and money from Omaha Steaks and other corporate donors and individual donors, are there in-kind products that you're in need of that some of the charities have really reached out for?
Well, and that's the beauty of going to shareomaha.org and shareiowa.org is that obviously on Giving Tuesday, the call to action is going to be for cash. But when you're on the website, you can't help but see the other needs that nonprofits are posting. So of course, the call to action for that big day, that big celebration is to give a cash donation. But if you want to start a relationship by purchasing something off their wish list or signing up for a volunteer opportunity over the holidays with your family, all of that isn't hidden on Giving Tuesday. All of it is still available for you to examine and make your decision about how to support.
What I like about it is you go to Share Omaha, and it's shareomaha.com.
.org,
excuse me. Is if you're thinking about giving and you want to get into the charitable mood, is you may not – You might think, oh, I've given to them, but what else is out there, and what are the needs? And this gives charities the opportunity to state what they're all about, what kind of products they need, as well as funds.
Well, and like you said, in our minds, just as residents of a community, there's like the five or six nonprofits that come to mind when you think of nonprofits. But like I said, we have 700 plus nonprofits on the website, and we re-randomize the sort of how those are presented. So if you were to click that you support families, or you support a certain health mission, or you support Latino, Latinx communities, things of that nature, you can click all of those causes, all of those ways to shrink that 700 down to the ones that are most critical. They're served up to you on a level playing field, non-alphabetical, not by when they joined the website, not by budget size. So you're meeting niche nonprofits as well as those large nonprofits that you would expect to hear from as well. So it's really an opportunity to meet a new nonprofit.
So tell us about Giving Tuesday is November 29th?
Yes.
And there's got to be some healthy competition among the not-for-profits.
Yes. And so nonprofits are raising their own bonus pools, their own bonus funds based upon like their boards of directors, things of that nature, giving to their organization if they meet certain goals throughout the day, things of that nature. But what we really love about the bonus fund division is that it's not so much based upon the dollars raised. It's based upon it's divided by donor. So organizations will receive a percentage of the total bonus fund equivalent to the percentage of donors they received, up to 10% of the total fund. So every gift matters is what we're trying to explain, is that it's not about, of course, if you have a $5,000 gift to make that gift that day. But if you have $50, $100, $25,
right, it still counts
toward the bonus pool. Absolutely.
Just another minute with Marjorie Moss from Share Omaha, Giving Tuesday coming up on November 29th. Marjorie, if companies want to get involved in the bonus fund and join Omaha Steaks and PayPal and Kiewit, how do they do that?
They go to shareomaha.org. You can find my information on about us, or it's just marjorie@shareomaha.org. I'm the main contact for that piece of information. Or if you're from Iowa, contact Donna Dostal at the Community Foundation for Western Iowa. Her information is pretty easy to find as well.
And finally, on November 29th, 9th. If regular folks like me want to participate in Giving Tuesday, how do we do that?
You go to shareomaha.org or shareiowa.org. Click at the very top for more information. There'll be a big banner ad. You can't miss it. Or just dive into the website. It's very intuitive. It's an experience that is probably the best and most gratifying shopping experience you're going to have.
Well, that's very cool. Marjorie, we appreciate you joining us, and thanks to everything that you and your colleagues are doing to make our city a better place.
You're welcome. Nonprofits are a huge piece of economic development, so thank you for having us today.
No doubt. Marjorie Moss, head of Share Omaha, coming up, Giving Tuesday coming up November 29th. Going to take our final break of the hour, and when we come back, it's going to be time for the Turner Construction Lightning Round. Lots of things on the list. You don't want to miss any of it. You're listening to Jeff and Trenton on Grow Omaha, brought to you by D&M Roofing and Dingman's Collision Center. Back in a moment on News Radio 1110 KFAB.
Thanks so much. Radio
that's a little shtick that we do.
What's that?
It's all radio theater of the mind.
Thank you guys so much. Great questions. Well, I really appreciate the conversation very much.
And you can link it or whatever. Roger will have it up tomorrow, Roger.
Tomorrow morning.
Oh, no problem. I posted our picture on my Facebook already. I'm sure my marketing director will do some more work with that.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's good to get to know you. Yeah, good luck with all of that. Yeah.
You've spoken to groups I've been to before, but I don't think we've ever had a chance to actually meet. Yeah. So thank you so much for having me on today.
My pleasure.
Nice to meet you. Amy, nice to meet you.
Enjoy your weekend, Marjorie.
Thank you.
Marjorie.
It's been a long
Little King opening November 1st.
Okay. In fact, you mentioned it's already put it on the list.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we'll have more to talk about than we have time, which is good. Let's see, here are the other things.
We're going to have about 4 minutes.
Perfect, which means 3.5 after we do our Turner promo.
Yeah.
Lux American Grill, Let It Fly, Floor and Decor, Ashley Wagner Fitness, Canara, Alma Draft House. That's kind of old news. I'll do this first, though, to make sure you get it in.
Yeah.
So, and we won't worry about that last thing. Okay, let's pull up this. I need the cheat sheet.
When your ride fires on all cylinders, so do you. That's why Napa is on a mission to keep you in motion.
I got that from Rush Limbaugh.
And a stack of stuff.
Napa Network has everything you need to get up and go.
What are you up to today?
Let's get a lot of work done. I'm going to do yard work. I got to work on Bradford a little bit. And maybe watch a little bit of college football. 6 months ago? So hopefully soon. I'm not complaining because life is really good right now, but I can't get it all done.
Did you give the same discount to NAI?
Okay.
As last year.
Here we go.
Tell you there.
And welcome back to the show. Jeff Beals and Trenton Magid in the penthouse studio at KFAB high above Underwood Avenue. And we are going to bring you the Turner Construction Lightning Round right now. Turner Construction is our proud sponsor and love everything they're doing in Omaha. Turner is this firm with tremendous capabilities, a deep, deep bench of resources, a deep bench of talent, and so much experience building big, medium, and large construction projects. You know, a lot of people here know them because of the Sarpy County Data Center. And good grief, if you've not driven by the Sarpy County Data Center lately on Highway 50, you are missing out.
It keeps going and going.
It's like a huge city of data center and warehouse buildings, and it's just over the top cool. Billions of dollars worth of investment, and Turner Construction doing such a good job of building it responsibly and very practically.
And it's neat to see their signs throughout Omaha as well.
Yeah, a lot of spaces. So a lot of spaces that they're building and improving. So if your company needs a builder, Turner Construction is where you want to start. And if you are a person in the trades looking for a great place to work, Turner Construction is definitely going to be a candidate for your job search. So let's get into it. Trenton, first of all, Little King is opening a new location on Dodge November 1st.
Very excited. My friend Chip James had the inspiration to take over Little King about a year ago. And this is a state-of-the-art facility, and there'll be many more of them. But right there where Cast meets West Dodge Road, you can't miss it. And drive through and sit down And it'll open November 1.
A lot of people were disappointed this week to hear that Alamo Drafthouse Cinema has closed its Midtown location at 32nd and Farnham Street. Now, the La Vista location remains open. We did talk with Molly Scold, our friend who is a VP of marketing for Midtown Crossing and East Campus Realty, and she said they are actively working with a new user that is going to take that space, reposition it. Announcement is expected soon. It's supposed to be, it's probably going to be a pretty big deal.
There's some new restaurants at Midtown Crossing I want to try.
Yeah, which ones do you want to try?
Well, this is Smokin'
Oak.
Yeah, Smokin' Oak is, looks good.
Yeah.
And then where Grey Plume was.
Yes, that is called Sofra.
Yeah.
Yeah, Sofra. I've been wanting to try that one too. Lux American Grill has opened in Papillion at 96th and Portal Road. It's in the first floor of a four-story mixed-use building. It joins Cafe Diem and Just Popped Popcorn. Apartments are on the upper levels. Texas Day Brazil is now officially open in the Capital District. And just east of that space, window signs have gone up for Let It Fly, which is going to be a very large, very cool sports bar out of South Dakota. They also have a location in Tennessee. Now, this is one that a lot of people have been waiting for, Trenton. Floor and Decor has finally come to Nebraska, opened its first store a couple days ago.
In the shadow of NFM.
Yep, at 350 Rose Blumpkin Drive. And now they're open. The grand opening is going to be coming up on October 17th, but this is out of Atlanta, founded in 2000, 170 locations, and they'll be a nice complement to the Mart.
Absolutely.
Ashley Wagner Fitness is moving from 140th and West Center Road to 120th and Blondo Street. And Kanara, the popular Indian restaurant, last day at Millard will be tomorrow and then reopening end of the month in Regency Shopping Center. That's it for this week. I'm Jeff Beals.
And I'm Trenton Maggett.
You've been listening to Grow Omaha, brought to you by Turner Construction, Dingman's Collision Center, and D&M Roofing and Siding. We'll chat with you next week at 9 o'clock right here on News Radio 1110 KFAB.
If you like this video, be sure to hit those like and subscribe buttons. And remember, Grow Omaha is not just media. This is a mission. We are trying to build up Omaha and make it an even better place. We can only do that with your help. Share this video with your friends, neighbors, and family.